What's going on, Reef Builders? I'm Jake Adams, bringing to you a very fun update on a very fun aquarium. I was checking out the calendar and I realized that it's been just about 5 months since I first introduced you to the first concept aquarium here at the Reef Builder Studio, which is the Christmas Tree Warm Rock Concept Aquarium. I have learned a lot, and it's interesting how much this tank has changed, but has come back full circle to kind of refocus on the worms. And it looks very similar to how I introduced it in the video back in mid-December. So it's the beginning of summer. It's really warm here. It's a far cry from the mid-December when this tank was first being set up. And what I'm trying to get at is I still have my Christmas tree up. As you can tell, though, it's an aquarium, and it's been a real delight. It's definitely been pioneering new ground, because while we've kept Christmas worm rocks and Christmas worms with our corals in our aquariums for years, there hasn't really been any concentrated efforts to keep basically colonies of these together, specifically to display the worms. What's the biggest thing that you can see after 5 months of having these guys? Well, they're all doing great, and I just rewatched the video from 5 months ago, just kind of give me some frame of reference of what this tank was like, and definitely the worms have gotten bigger. Not so much on the green varieties where they were already kind of big, but this colony right here of Cyphastria, the worms have gotten really huge, and the colony behind it, the worms are so abundant that they are actually almost seem to be shading the coral, which brings me to one of the first kind of observations about these corals, about these combinations of corals and worms. A little bit better than the corals, and I think part of the reason for that was because I was feeding so much. Now, when the tank is new and fresh and all the surfaces are clean, the Aquamedic Eco Drift that I had in there was doing a beautiful, perfect standing wave. It's all I needed. When I first started to take care of this tank, I noticed that, you know, the food and the waste was really building up in certain sections where the water flow was reduced, and what that caused was just kind of a buildup of detritus, and also the heavy feeding resulted in like the biggest aptasia outbreak I've ever experienced, because I've never fed that much. I've never fed this much to any tank, so I've never had aptasia go out of control like that. So it's actually taken months to like come back around and like get the aptasia under control. So this tank has had a variety of corals on this side, some corals on the bottom, but right now the only other inhabitants with the Christmas tree worms and their hosts are a couple of dendrophilias that you see here in the back, just because there's so much food going into this tank that they really appreciate it. But I am very much looking forward to setting up more of a dedicated NPS tank where they won't be directly lit, and I won't have to worry about algae growth and just, you know, grow all the NPS. Yes, corals. One of the interesting things that I learned is I always wonder what the relationship is between the worms and the corals. And in this particular setup, it really does look like the worms are having the upper hand, and they're almost like shading the corals, both kind of blocking them from flow and blocking them from light. So one of the things that I did two things. Upgraded the pump, upgraded the light. Both are much more controllable than the ones before. So The Aquamatic Eco Drift had its time, but I upgraded to the AI Nero 5 because that thing is so strong that it creates about the same wave at 50% power. And I also upgraded the light to a MaxSpec Razor 2. This is a light. The MaxSpec Razor is one of the most underappreciated, underrated lights. I don't know why we don't see them everywhere. It's such a beautiful, powerful, controllable strip light. And the lid. So the lid together with the worms was shading the corals. So we have a much brighter light here, and it also has more color to it. So the worms simply just look better. And there's a lot more light getting down to the corals. But the AI Nero 5, I've set it up before, and I have to tell you, I was so delighted at being able to take this pump out of the box, put it in place, get it connected to the new Mobius program, get it recognized, and get it programmed to do a wave in the tank, and then programming it to do constant current in the middle of the night. All of that in about 5 minutes. 5 minutes of wireless programming control. It was next level, awesome, awesome experience. And that's important because, you know, with something that's not programmable like the EcoDrift, you know, you have to kind of get on there and you can tweak with it and you can get a good setting. But for something a little more sophisticated like this tank, what I really wanted was to maintain the standing wave that I really love because it's really cool to kind of see the worms go back and forth. But in the middle of the night, there is a 3 to 4 hour window. I don't remember exactly how long I made it since I programmed it. There's like a 3 to 4 hour window where the Nero 5 is on constant flow. And that's really, really helping to flush out everything from this aquarium and keeping it super clean. So when I was feeding so much, it was definitely, this tank was getting scuzzy. It was really just kind of building up in there because I wasn't flushing it out the way you would want. But I cleaned the bejesus out of this tank manually probably like 3 weeks ago. It looks like I cleaned it 2 days ago. Like, totally unbelievable how much better this tank is doing with the new light, with the new pump. The worms are all so much bigger. The parietes are definitely responding much better to the increased water flow and also the extra light because the worms are getting so big that they were shading so much of the coral. And you can really see that on this parietes right here. They're not even all open, but like when I stand 5 or 6 feet away, all I see is a bouquet of Christmas worms. So not all the corals have fared super duper well. This is a Cyphastrea colony. If you'll remember from the previous video, that particular colony had a lot of very small worms. They've all grown. The smaller the worm, the more they've grown since 5 months ago. So these have all grown, and I don't know if it was just a lack of flow or just too many worms, but the Cyphastrea on here is almost gone. The thing I can say is that Cyphastrea was never super robust, so I don't know if it was like already on the way out, but it seems like a perfect opportunity to repopulate it with some much more colorful Cyphastreas because it was the most doo-doo brown shade, not doo-doo brown, but it was the most like yucky shade of like barely mint green Cyphastrea you've ever seen. So we are going to try it again with some Bizarro or some Meteor Shower, or maybe put one on both sides and see what happens. So this answers an interesting question. Do the worms have to have a coral host to live? Well, it seems to me that they've kind of like killed this one. I don't know why, but I don't think they need the host to live. It's more of a protection thing in the wild. What else? One of the first challenges I had with this particular aquarium is shortly after I set this tank up and shared the video with you guys of these worm rocks, every few days or a couple times a day, I started seeing their operculum, their little trap door that they use to block off the hole. And I would just see them just kind of floating around here. And I thought that I was losing some Christmas worms, and I was kind of bummed about it because I figured it was a really integral part of their anatomy. The thing is, I never found the Christmas worm gills. I never found any worm parts, and I never found like any vacant holes where a worm used to be. And if you look at the worms, I mean, it's looked like there's more than there's ever been. So I've come to the conclusion that the Christmas worm rocks, Christmas worms can actually shed their operculum, because in the wild, like a lot of things could build up on them. Algae, coralline, all kinds of things that would actually kind of be a drag, like literally a drag for them to open and close. So I believe that they can shed their operculum without it, you know, completely dying. So that was an interesting realization that took a few weeks to get around to, but this is what happens when you break new ground. The hermit crabs in there are doing well. The basic barnacles in there are still there. I've come across some colonies of Christmas worm rocks that would be a complement to this, but honestly, I just kind of wanted to write out these four pieces. I mean, there's over 100 worms in here. I think I have enough for now. I've really enjoyed them. The only thing I've done to kind of add to the tank is I've added the convict tang and the purple tang, mostly to really just kind of help clean up and get in between the colonies and help keep the system super clean. But since I am feeding so much, I really want to get a school of Ventralis antheus. That's one of those fish that it's not like one holy grail fish, because I want the group, you know, and since I'm like clouding this tank up with food, this would be such a perfect place to just keep those Ventralis antheus super nice and fat. You know, three or four like super show males with like 6 to 8 females. It's just such a small, gorgeous fish. They have a big kind of ledge here to kind of hang out under. I think they would absolutely love it. So let's come back around to one of the most important things for taking care of these Christmas tree worm rocks, and that is the food. So I've talked about the water flow to deliver the food, increased water flow to get rid of the uneaten food, and increasing the light to make sure the coral hosts are happy and healthy. So when I started this aquarium, I was just kind of throwing the entire menu of reef aquarium foods at this tank, but I have really settled in on using Brightwell's Reef Blizzard O. When Brightwell, a chemical additive company and channel sponsor, years ago when they came out with the food, I always thought it was kind of bizarre to see a chemical additive maker supply a food, and I think their first crack at food was kind of like a liquid supplement, and I don't know, I kind of chuckled at first to see a chemical company making those, but they make Reef Blizzard in 3 or 4 sizes, and it's really awesome because they cover a very narrow range of particle sizes, and I have found that this is the preferred food for the Christmas tree worms. And the way that I gauge that is how much they poop. And so a few hours after feeding this tank, it's almost like a snowstorm of just very small little poop noodles all throughout the tank. If you look closely, you can see these kind of thin orange strings kind of floating throughout the aquarium, and that's their poop. And you can really, really tell what they prefer to eat by how much of it they catch and how much of it they poop. So I think maybe like 75% of the time I'm feeding the Reef Blizzard O and kind of, you know, really targeting the worms because they have those really fine gills. But I also feed the Reef Blizzard S. So let me show you this. So this is a Reef Blizzard O. You see it's kind of like a phytoplankton mix, and it's a super fine powder. And then this one is a little bit more of a zooplankton mix, but they have a larger particle size, a Reef Blizzard A, I believe. And that's almost for like small fish and anemones. But the Reef Blizzard S, I will feed about 25% of the time, because when I'm feeding this tank, I'm actually feeding 200 gallons of corals behind it. So I want to feed the Reef Blizzard S once in a while to target the corals that are in here and the corals that are in the back. I know that they eat the Reef Blizzard S, but I see a lot more defecation after feeding the O than the S from the Christmas worms. I guess that kind of brings me back around to a final point about feeding, as I'm a big believer of if you have the time to soak the food, to saturate the food for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, an hour, 24 hours if you can, depending on the food that you're feeding, because I really feel like a fully hydrated dried food is going to be a lot easier to be caught and a lot more palatable for whatever reef creature catches it. and I was trying to do that for this aquarium, but I want to feed it like once or twice a day and create like this huge ginormous cloud. And man, it was just really burning a lot of time to try to soak up the food for this tank every single time. So I have pulled out a classic aquarium hack. I've got a feeding tube right there in the back, and basically that goes up above the surface. So I can come here from the back and I can just kind of drop some food into the cylinder, and the wave action that is raising and lowering the water level on that end of the tank is kind of helping to just kind of mix up the food. So as it gets hydrated, it sinks down that tube and falls basically right in to the AI Nero 5 and gets totally mixed up and blown all over the tank. So yeah, the tank is doing great. The worms are doing excellent. I have a little room for improvement to try to figure out how to keep the host corals a little happier. Hopefully the addition of the more powerful and more controllable Nero 5 is gonna help with some of that. And then adding the Max Becht Razor 2, giving it more light, is also gonna help with making those corals super happy. So I think the next step really is just adding some more parietes to this tank. You can see I've got one, basically a nude boulder parietes over here that I've put between some of the worm rocks to see if the worms will actually spawn and just kind of reseed locally. I swear that after I did the video of this tank 5 months ago, I started seeing like little small babies. And I don't know if those were residual worms that had already been embedded into the coral and started to show, or the residual larvae from maybe like brooded gametes from the worms that had just kind of crawled out locally. So the word is for me is still out on whether they can reproduce in aquariums, but I'm gonna add a lot more varieties to this tank in between the worm colonies and really see if it's possible for them to kind of spread. So, because these worms are getting like totally conditioned. We know very little about them, but I've learned a lot in 5 months of focusing on this tank. This has been such a cool concept aquarium, and it's been interesting to have some of the learning curves for what it takes to keep this tank on the system super clean, super happy, super healthy. So yeah, hope you've enjoyed this update. This is kind of one of the first aquariums of just kind of really trying to do something different within the reef aquarium hobby, which is still familiar and applicable to what we do on a daily basis with our community reef tanks. So thank you guys so much for checking out this video. I hope you enjoyed this feature, the spotlight on the flow, light, and food requirements for these interesting reef animals. I hope this is gonna serve as a template for so many more videos in the future. If you have any questions or comments, go ahead and leave those down below. I'm gonna put some supplemental links in the description. If you enjoyed this video, you know what to do. Give it a like. If you loved it, make sure and subscribe and hit that notification bell. We've got a lot of great reef tanks to update you guys on. So it's very rewarding to come back around to this tank, and performing and doing kind of what I hoped, and that is the direction we're going with the rest of the aquariums here at the Reef Builder Studio. So thanks again for tuning in. I'll catch you guys on the next one.